Catherine Tegan Books and Harper Audio present Boomi's Boombox by Shanthi Sekaran, performed by Sohm, Kapila. For Avi and Ash. Track 1. Another One Bites the Dust. There's something you should know about the summer. It's a time for dreamers and time wasters, for half-baked ideas and unfinished songs. It's a blink of a season. There's never enough of it. One day it's spring and the next it's autumn. But for a shimmering moment in the middle, summer steps into your life, your sudden best friend, taking your hand, babbling in your ear, showing you her secrets, promising to stay forever. But spring was another story. That spring, the only things babbling were the teachers on my laptop, all day, all week, all year long. I'd spent the entire sixth grade sitting at our kitchen table, staring at this screen, my classmates boxed into tidy, computerized rectangles. It was the second spring of the pandemic. COVID-19 had been sprinting around the world for a whole year, and it showed no signs of slowing. Before COVID, when I actually went to school, I was a person. A walking, talking, hand-raising, lunch-eating, test-taking person. On a computer screen, I was just a box with a face. I was nobody. I was nowhere. I spent most days gazing out of our living room window at the branches of a eucalyptus tree as cars hummed by on the street and my grandmother's game shows tinned from the television. Every now and then, I'd hear a spray of melody from my mom's office where she taught cello lessons online. I'd watch the gray morning sky turn to afternoon blue, then back to gray as the fog rolled in. Just wait for summer, I'd tell myself. Everything's better in the summer. And was it? Maybe. It was stranger, that's for sure. More impossible than anything I might have dreamed up those spring afternoons. Let's hit fast forward. Or is it rewind? My impossible summer started one weekend in July at tryouts for the Académie Fontaine, where I'd been a ballet student my whole life. I was 12, and 12-year-olds had to try out if they wanted to graduate to the studio company, the highest level of the academy. I'd been a ballet dancer since I was little, really little. My mom told me that before I could walk, she'd hold my hands above my head and help me glide along the floor on my tiptoes. I loved ballet from the second I saw Olga Petrov leap and spin across a computer screen. I was 6 years old, sitting on the sofa with mom. Olga was playing Clara from The Nutcracker, dressed in a long violet nightgown. She jumped and landed like a whisper, like she barely weighed an ounce. But let's get back to my story. The year was 2021. That's me, Boomi Gopalan, age 12, second from stage left. You've probably noticed my white tights with smudges on the knees, the black leotard, and the little paunch of a belly still hanging over my legs. The other girls, including my best friend, Bebe Jacobs, were dressed in white tights and black leotards too, but they seemed to have lost their paunches. I hadn't seen Bebe in person for over a year. Her face had changed. Her hair had grown, and now she wore it in a bun, like a real ballerina. Mom had tried to wind my hair into a bun, but it kept spinning out like a crazy pinwheel. She eventually gave up and tied it in a ponytail, which sagged lazily down my back now. In the front row sat Madame Fontaine, a clipboard bouncing on her lap as she jiggled one knee. Scattered through the rows behind her, the parents. They'd come to watch us for this final phase of auditions, our last chance to prove to Madame Fontaine that we belonged in the studio company, that we really and truly were company dancers, not little goofballs in tutus. 10 of us would be chosen, and the chosen would train 5 times a week. If I made it, my life would become dance, and dance would become my life. If I didn't make it, well, I didn't want to think about that. The stage lights cast a ghostly glow over the rows of seats, and I could see Bebe's mom tugging nervously at her mask. I could see my mom, her yellow scarf tied around her hair, gripping herself by the neck. The parents, all in masks, stared at us like we were juggling knives, like we were holding their lives in the perfect curves of our arabesques. And there I was, teetering into the spotlight on my pointe shoes. Those are the shoes you see ballet dancers perform in, the kind that let you dance right up on your toes like some kind of superhuman. I wasn't too confident on point. My tiptoes weren't my happy place, I guess. I was really more of a flat-on-my-feet person, more of a not-falling-over person. I hated pointe shoes so much that I tried to ditch them that morning. In the car, when Mom checked my bag and found the shoes missing, she was not amused. "What is your exact problem with pointe shoes?" she snapped. My exact problem with pointe shoes was that they hurt. But I didn't bother telling Mom that. She wouldn't understand. Madame's secretary moved down the audition list, calling out names. Bebe went before me. She was perfect. She danced like she was born on point. She seemed not to even notice the 3 grand jetés we had to do. She leaped and landed like she'd done those big arcing jumps every day of her life. I could have watched her dance all day. But then, "Boomi di Gopalan," the secretary called. Normally, when I dance, the rest of the world falls away. I couldn't tell you who I was, what I had for breakfast, or what homework was due the next day. Dance was an animal that lived inside me, and when I let it loose, it took me over. Each time I did a turn, the animal lifted my heels for me. It thrust my arms. It snapped my head around in perfect sync. But during my audition that day, my mind kept getting in the way. I started to remember things that had nothing to do with dance. One second, I was glissading across the stage. And the next, I saw Dad's jacket hanging on the kitchen chair, just where he'd left it the day he got sick. One second, I was doing a grand jeté. And the next, I saw Dad in a hospital bed, a tube sticking out from his mouth, soaring through the air in a saut de chat, then at a funeral home holding my mom's hand. Then I was back on stage for the final steps of the piece, the beret en carreux. When you really nail it, you look like a swan skimming across a lake, the movements of your feet so tiny and precise that they hardly seem to move at all. I lifted onto my toes, but just as I took that first step, I thought again of that tube going into Dad's mouth. My feet forgot what to do. My ankles buckled. My arms swung in big, frantic circles as I tried to regain my balance. Finally, my legs gave way. I spilled like a pile of rocks onto the hard wood surface of the stage. And then I just sat there on my butt, blinking out at the dim rows of seats, at my mom, whose hands had moved to her cheeks, who sat there with her eyes closed like she was trying to be anywhere but in that auditorium. And just like that, my ballet days were over. Track 2. Walls Come Tumbling Down. An hour later, Madame's secretary stepped out of the office, holding a sheet of paper that listed the 10 chosen Academy dancers. She walked in rapid steps down the hallway, pinching the list between her thumb and forefinger and holding it at a distance like it smelled bad. Then she pinned the list to the bulletin board, took one look at the mob approaching, and hightailed it out of there. 6 feet apart, someone's mom kept yelling. No one listened. Students and parents crowded around the list, jostling to get a good look. Squeals and whoops erupted from the dancers who'd made it. I searched for my name. Boomika Devi Gopalan. A little spark of hope fizzed in my chest as my eyes moved through the names. Sure, I'd crash-landed on stage, but at least I'd stood out. Different could be good sometimes, right? Right? Wrong. 10 names. Bebe Jacobs was one of them. Boomika Devi Gopalan was not. Of course I didn't make it. The group scattered, some of us chattering happily, some of us in tears. Some of us were dancers still. The rest of us? Well, I guess the rest of us just weren't. That's when I felt my mom tugging at my wrist, leading me down the long hallway away from the exit. We're going the wrong way, I warned her. Oh, no, we're not. Next thing I knew, her knuckles were rapping on Madame Fontaine's office door. My heart pounded. My throat went dry. The door opened. It wasn't the secretary. It was Madame herself. She teetered over as like an ancient tree, her big, round glasses balanced on the tip of her nose. Mom has an English accent, and usually the second she opens her mouth, people fall a little bit in love with her. But Madame Fontaine had a French accent, so I guess she wasn't impressed by Mom's English one. She gazed down, bored and impatient as Mom prattled on. I don't really know what Mom was even saying because I was focused on Madame's glasses. Every few seconds, they slid down her nose, and Madame pushed them back up again. I could hear Mom's voice tremble, like she was about to cry. I knew she wasn't faking it. I wondered if she'd actually break into sobs, but like Madame Fontaine's glasses, she held on. She said what she had to say, and Madame's answer in her prim French accent, I remember it word for word. Boomi is a very good dancer, very good, but she is big. My cheeks flamed up, my insides twisted and tangled. The lady didn't miss a beat, just said it straight out. She is big. And she didn't stop there. In this academy, she said, we look for a certain shape of the body. This becomes very important in my experience as dancers progress. If Boomi lost the weight, would you reconsider? Mom's question rang through the empty hallway. Madame Fontaine said nothing. Her eyes flitted from my face to my legs and back again. Then she disappeared into her office and came back with a file folder. She looked through it for a few seconds. Well, she said, her bar and center work were just fine. But more important, Boomi is incapable of dancing on point. Madame Fontaine had a point. Ha ha. We all saw me fall. The fact of my fall walked up and stood there right next to me, hairy and ridiculous, like Bigfoot in a tutu. Madame Fontaine pursed her lips and gazed down at me. Good day, then. Thank you for your time. She gave her glasses one last hearty shove and started to close the door. Wait! Mom grabbed the door, stopped it from closing. I don't remember the rest very well because I don't want to. I stood there and tried not to hear when Mom said, her father, and just last year. And a hard time, a second chance, her weight issue, point shoes. Madame Fontaine sniffed down at her folder and gazed at me for a few endless seconds. I'll have to speak to the board, she said. We do have a wonderful modern dance program open to all abilities. Children love it. Good day. She slammed the door shut. Mom stared at me, her eyelids drooping, her face sagging. On the drive home, she was quiet, her silence filling the car. Lights reflected from the street slid across her face, her eyes barely blinking. She looks nothing like me. I'm sure she'd make a perfect ballerina. She's small and delicate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.